must be some kind of way out of here. To the joker, to the thief. There's too much confusion, and I can't get no relief.
All right, so when I first had the idea to do a podcast or to do a show, one of the examples that I used as things I wanted to talk about was something called the Darien Gap. And people are like, what are you talking about? The Darien Gap? You know, what is that? I've never even heard of that. And I'm like, I know. That's why I want to talk about it. Because the concept of the Darien Gap, the existence of the Darien Gap, and the fact that it exists today in the world that we live in, with the advanced technology and the, you know, self-driving cars, electric cars, private people taking, you know, their own private spaceships up to, you know, quote unquote, outer space. But there is still a section of land that's roadless, that's mapless, that has no police, that has no EMTs, that if you are there, you're on your own. That if anyone's out there and they know that shit, they have the leverage on you. That there are poisonous snakes, poisonous insects, jaguars, flash floods, impregnable tropical forests, and huge mountains. All that exists in like a space of 60 kilometers. That's it, man. So the Pan American Highway goes from Prudhoe, Alaska, all the way down to Cayon, Chile. 30,000 kilometers, the Pan American Highway. But there's a little gap. There's a little gap where Panama meets Colombia, and it's 66 kilometers. And the Pan American Highway is too chicken to go through that place. And that place is called the Darien Gap. And it's where Panama meets Colombia. And as I described, it is mapless, it's roadless, it has almost impregnable tropical forests, it has crazy rivers, it has crazy wildlife. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. It also has cartels, and it also has anti-government guerrillas. So, I don't know, it might have real guerrillas too. Who knows? I don't know. There's all kinds of shit out there. So, it is a place where you are literally on your own. And so today I have a guest, Carlos Villalon. And Carlos, you're a photographer. Is that what you do? Yeah, you're a photographer. You live in Bogota, Colombia. And how many times have you been in the Darien Gap? How many times have you crossed it? And what got you to go in there in the first place?
Well, hello. You know, it's very strange. I mean, the first time I went to the region I call the Darien Gap, because actually the Darien Gap is just a name some people use, you know, but this is the province of Chocó in Colombia, where the gap is located, no? But the first time I went to the Darien Gap, I think it was in 2004, on an assignment with the New York Times. It was just an assignment about indigenous communities, but the place, we were navigating the Salaki River, and the place, I don't know, it has something that called my attention, and I was asking people what was upriver, and they were telling me, well, Panama is up there, you know, so I kept like curious about, and a year after this assignment, I read like a small paragraph in a Colombian newspaper that read, Chinese migrants caught by authorities in the Darien Gap. That was it. And like my curiosity became like way, way stronger. And I decided I need to see this place. I need to go to this place. I want to see what's going on there. I mean, it's the second time this place kind of like appears on my face. And I need to go. So this is where it all started, like year 2004.
Is that when you first decided? Did you have you crossed it all the way from? I believe you have, because I actually watched a documentary with you in it, and I think it did show you crossing the Darien Gap, right, from Colombia to Panama.
Yeah, you know, like the first time I crossed. I mean, this started, as I told you, about immigration. You know, I mean, I wanted to do this strange story about Chinese people being caught in the Darien Gap. So I started looking for that, no? And, you know, it supposedly, for what I heard, like migrants were crossing the border between Colombia and Panama. And I looked for these mysterious migrants for like 3 years, and I never saw anyone attempting to cross, or migrants. So on 2007, I was like, you know, I'm gonna cross this place anyways, with or without migrants, because I need to know the experience. So the first time I crossed the gap was in 2007. And up today, I think I have crossed the Darien, like from one border to the other, 5 times. And then other than that, I've been in the Darien, like, or either way on the Colombian or Panamanian side so many times, I just lost count, you know, yeah. Because this is what I'm doing lately. It's like a documentary or a book on the Darien Gap.
So when you crossed it, like, what did you use? Like, because I know that people use rafts, but of course the weather has to be right, because you do get the flash floods. Is it a mixture of rafts and hiking? And because those mountains that we're talking about, because it's hard for, I think, some people to understand that you go from swamps up to mountains that are almost 3,000 meters, right? So these are really, really tall hikes that you have to have there.
Well, actually, you know, the tallest mountain is the Takarkuna Hills in Arequipa, and I think the tallest wouldn't go past to like 1,400 meters. I think the tallest actually is like 1,200, you know? But at this point, it doesn't matter how high it is, because it's pure jungle, which usually is like muddy as hell, you know? And it's very hot. Super hot. I mean, we're talking like 40 Celsius degrees and humidity of probably 90%. So at that point, like when you are at the foot of the mountain, it feels like hell anyways. I mean, it really doesn't matter if it's 3 or 5,000. It's just like the terrain, the way the terrain is, the mud is raining all the time. You know, and when it's not raining, it's incredible hot. So it's like a very difficult place to be in, you know.
So I think I've read that that the mud isn't like normal mud, that the mud in the gap has some certain type of viscosity, and you guys wear like these tall boots, one to protect against the bites of some of the, you know, venomous snakes, but also to keep that mud, you know, out of the feet. Is that true? Is there like a certain type of viscosity to that mud that you find in those rivers and in the land there?
Yeah, you know, it's very dirty, and especially now, you know, with all this huge migration wave, it's way dirtier. I mean, I was there like 2 weeks ago, and it's sad. Actually, it's very sad, because I used to walk years ago before you see any migrants. Like in 2006, 2007, I used to walk in this river called Acandiseco, which is one of the ways to get into Panama. There's so many roads. But this river was gorgeous, was incredible, peaceful, beautiful. And now, 2 weeks ago, I saw like 1 ton of used diapers, Coca-Cola bottles, clothing that people who go there doesn't know if that clothing is going to be appropriate. So it's not, you know. So you see plenty of jackets, blue jeans, shoes everywhere. I mean, this is something that really made me very sad, because this place is very important in terms of like ecology. You know, we're talking like the most important jungle or green place in the Americas after the Amazon. We don't have another one. This is it. It's the Amazon and the Darien Gap, the Darien jungle, and it's being wasted. Like, you know, people, of course, we have to understand, you know, people that are walking through there these days are desperate. You know, they're like running away from war, running away from poverty. They don't even have, in lots of cases, their own country. They don't want to go back to Haiti, let's say. And they're desperate to get to a safe place with their families. But anyways, they throw everything they have on their backs in the jungle. You know, I mean, I don't feel like giving like an ecology lesson to these people at this moment, because it would be ridiculous, you know, but still, I mean, you cannot drink water from the main river now. I used to drink water like 2 years ago from the river, and it was fantastic, you know, ice cold, tasty. And now I wouldn't dare. I mean, I don't even ask him if this water is clean or not, but I just don't. I know it's not clean anymore.
So, you know, and I'm glad you brought that up, because that's one of the things I want to talk about. Because as I watched a number of documentaries on the Darien Gap, and I saw these immigrants, and most of them come, and this is not, hey, as you mentioned, we're not trying to judge why they're doing this, right? That's not what we're here for. I think we're just talking about the Darien Gap and the impact that they have, because we're talking about tens and tens of thousands of immigrants that are going up and down through this pristine ecological, you know, preserve, not preserved. Well, kind of, because the governments have kind of said, we don't want to build through here because of the ecology of that area, that it's pretty much untouched. That was one of the reasons, actually, Carlos, right, that they decided not to continue the Panama. One is that we have about 8,000 tribal members, I think, from five tribes that still live in the gap. And I'm curious, from your perspective, what does this immigration train, what kind of effect does that have on those indigenous people right there in that area with the pollution and et cetera?
You know, I mean, in the beginning, indigenous, especially the Kuna people, which are not called Kuna, you know, they changed their name like maybe 4 years ago. So now they're Kuna Dule. Okay. But it's the people everyone knows as Kuna, you know, and they weren't too aware about this immigration. You know, it wasn't in that huge numbers as it is today. So they let immigrants, mainly from Africa, mm-hmm. to go into their reservations or their communities, you know. And like a year went by, and you see in these very small hamlets, because they're not even towns, you see these indigenous people, you know, talking to people from Somalia or Ghana or Congo. And I thought it was very interesting. But then like a year after, I stopped seeing these migrants in the communities. And I asked why. And the Saila, which is the one of the three men that run a community, told me that they started to have problems. Like the migrants were like bringing in alcohol. You cannot drink in these villages. The Saila also told me some migrants were like once in a while, you know, trying to pick up on a young girl, you know, or there were fights. So as soon as the migration started, on a big wave, like on 2011, by 2012, migrants were forbidden for all Kuna Dule communities. You know, and you don't see them anymore. I mean, basically up to today, migrants won't go where there's communities, small towns or hamlets. They just roam around the jungle through different paths, you know. Mm. Of course, it still have an impact on the communities, because probably as it happened to me, they cannot drink the water from the river, you know. And this is like, it's going to have a huge effect on these communities. I mean, there's plenty of water in the Darien, plenty. Like, okay, you cannot drink from the main river, but if you walk like, I don't know, 100 meters, you're going to see little streams coming down the mountain to feed that river, and you can drink there. But still, I think it's going to be a big impact in the indigenous communities somehow.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of interesting, because I don't think I've ever seen anything from an environmental group about the impact that these immigration trains are having on that ecologically pristine area. And again, not judging on the immigration path there, or I mean, why they're coming. But geez, this is just a pristine area. And I wish we could, you know, I don't think the world knows. I don't think the world knows. I don't think the world knows what the Darien Gap is. And two, I don't think they know the damage that is befalling this, you know, very pristine area right now. So I think your voice is important. What about the cartels now? Because I know the cartels, don't they use the Darien also as a pathway from Colombia up to Central and North America?
Yeah, you know, I mean, this is the borders with Panama, you know. In the beginning, I would say in the 80s, you had the FARC, Marxist group, controlling most of the Darien. And they used to bring weapons from the Central American wars into Colombia. But then late in the or mid 80s, when cocaine became like a huge business here in Colombia, cocaine used to go up north. So what happened in this part of history in the Darien, you always had two groups. I mean, you had the FARC and the paramilitaries right there in the Darien, you know, like a little bit farther south, you have the ELN, which is another Marxist group, armed group. But basically the people, the armed people that has been controlling the Darien in the last 30 years are either way FARC or paramilitaries. And today in like current history are the paramilitaries controlling the border. And, you know, there's always been movement of drugs, specifically cocaine, you know. I mean, you have huge amounts of cocaine going north from the Urabá Gulf. You know, you have like these like semi-submergibles, which is like an imitation of a submarine. Mm-hmm. Or you have like go-fast boats, plenty of them. But there's also people walking the jungle with huge cargos of cocaine. So sometimes you run into, let's say, 20 young guys walking in the jungle, apparently doing nothing. But in reality, they're bringing like, I don't know, something like 25 kilos of cocaine each on each backpack, you know? So there's always being cartels. Now there's huge talks. I don't know if it's really true that the Mexican cartels are operating in the Darien Gap, you know? I mean, I don't see it impossible, because basically most of this cocaine, it goes to Mexico anyways and then to United States. But I wouldn't doubt that maybe some guys from some Mexican cartels, you know, probably Sinaloa, are in some parts of the Darien controlling the business. You know, they're making business with the cartels, and somehow they have to see like the quality of the product they're buying. So I wouldn't doubt there's Mexican cartel people in some towns in the Darien, but I wouldn't say like Mexican cartels are operating in the Darien. I don't think the Urabeños or the Gulf clan, mm-hmm, which are the guys controlling the region right now, are going to allow this to happen, you know?
So do the cartel folks, whether they be from, you know, Sinaloa, whether they be from Colombia, do they ever meet with the immigrants? And how does that go? Like, have you been with them when they've run into each other, or do they have separate journeys through there, separate pathways? How does that all work out?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think you asked me if I ever met them or.
Oh,
yeah. You know, I mean,
do they ever run into the immigrants?
First of all, to do this, to start working in the Darien, I knew someone was in charge. I mean, before going in there, I tried to read a lot about the Darien. And at some point, I realized that the Elmer Cardenas blog at that time, which was a faction of the self-defense units of Colombia, I mean, extreme right paramilitaries, were in charge of the region. So my first approach, of course, had to be to them. So I found an email address of the commander of the Elmer Cardenas block, and I wrote to him saying I wanted to explore the Darien Gap. I wanted to visit the region. I was very interested in migration. And a year went by and I never had any answers. So I figured this is not going to work for me. I mean, it's one of the stories you wanted to do, and it's not going to work because I have waited for a year. But then a year later, I get a phone call, someone saying that they were like the one of the generals of this Darien Gap boss, you know, of the Elmer Cardenas group. And they say the commander Aleman, or the German, they used to call him in Spanish, is waiting for you in some very far away place from Bogota. So after I received that phone call, I traveled and I met with this commander and I explained everything I wanted to do in the Darien, and he authorizes me. And I was working there with that permit. I mean, this guy's demobilized in 2006, and I met with the guy in 2005. But then since I had the permit, I guess the permit was good for many, many years. And I was going to the Darien all the time, photographing in the towns, in the jungle, so local people knew me. And then when I needed another permit and the Elmer Cardenas wasn't operating anymore there because they've been demobilized, I talked to some local guys I know, and they prepare a meeting between me and the Gulf clan. So I also met with these guys and I explained what I wanted to do, you know. I talked to them about if they wanted to give me interviews or invite me to some camp and photograph their people, but that haven't worked yet. But at least in the last meeting, they told me that I was like, okay, being in the region, photographing, like they knew me for so many years before, so it wasn't a problem. So I still kind of like have a permit to go to the Darien and do most of the things I want to do, except for a few ones. You know, I would love to see them uploading a semi-submergible full of cocaine, you know, but this is going to, I think it's going to take me a little bit of work.
It's going to be a little longer. There are short games and there are long games, Carlos. I think that's the long game. So the Gulf Clan cartel does have their fingers in the Darien.
Yeah, they're controlling pretty much, I would say, probably 90% of the Darien, like at the border with Panama nowadays.
Okay.
For sure.
So the immigrant, the train of immigration that runs through, are they okay with it? Or do you think that's part of the business?
It's part of the business, you know. I mean, as I told you, I was there 2 weeks ago, and I noticed that the the people from the Gulf cartel, if they're not organizing this migration through their turf, they are letting local people to do it, you know? So they always have their control hand in everything that happens, specifically at the border, you know? I mean, the border is a serious money-making thing, you know, because of cocaine. But I'm pretty sure these guys also are benefiting from the migration crisis, you know? I mean, the prices everyone is charging in the Darien nowadays to the migrants are ridiculous. I mean, you buy one garbage bag for $1, you know, or you can have like a very simple meal of like chicken soup and rice for $14. You know, it's crazy. I mean, something that I never seen before in the Darien or anywhere in Colombia regarding immigration.
Yeah, you know, I think it was actually watching one of your documentaries. I think the one that you did for Australia, and they had the guides. Well, where do the guides come from? Who are these guys? Are these indigenous people? Or are these people brought down by some of the organizations to do the guide jobs?
No, the guides are basically people that are locals, you know, like, let's say in this specific case, people from a town called Akandi or Kapurgana, they're right at the border. And these guys are local people that have been roaming the jungle forever, their entire lives. So they've been, you know, looking for gold in the past, or timber, or fishing, or hunting. And these guys have like an incredible knowledge of the place. So whoever is organizing all this migration going through Akandi today hires these local young people to guide the migrants. You know, last 2 years ago, you had a huge problem in the Colombian side. Like, nothing was organized. Everything was like, oh, okay, I'm going to be a guide, so I'm going to go to the jungle and pick up migrants for a fee, you know? And lots of crime occurred in the Colombian-Panamanian border, perpetrated by young Colombian kids that actually live in these same towns, you know? And there were like murders, there were like robbers. The guy who would carry your bag all the way up to the mountain summit would later on send your friends to rob you, you know, in the right on the Panamanian side. So there was like this incredible, huge crime wave going on. And I'm pretty sure paramilitaries or the Gulf clan people, for one reason specifically, you know, all these robbers and murders and rapes caught the press attention, you know. So at some point, as in Colombia, they say the Darien got very hot on the news, you know. And this would bring more police or more Colombian army into the jungle to investigate these things. And this would totally be or create havoc for the main business, you know, the cocaine business, the business that really makes money. So what happened? I figure the paramilitaries decided this has to stop because we don't want a daily presence of police or army here in our turf. So they organized this thing so well. I mean, they're making money. Everyone is making money. But I can assure you today, if you're a migrant, you're not going to run any risk or harm in the entire stretch that it means Colombia, you know, like from Akandi to the mountain that divides Colombia and Panama, you won't get on any trouble because these guys are basically being paid by migrants, but organized by this Gulf clan, you know. And if you're working for the Gulf clan and you rob a bag or try to, you know, try to have something sexual with a woman there, you're going to be seen and the Gulf clan is going to take care of you. So like what's going on today, you have like 500 to 700 migrants crossing Colombia towards Panama and nothing wrong is happening to these migrants because the business is controlled by the Gulf clan. And very important too, all the local guys are people that have like an incredible knowledge of the jungle and all the paths. So by working together, locals and the Gulf clan, they assure you, you're not going to have any problems crossing Colombia. Now, all the huge wave crime is happening, but in Panama, like 3 days from the border.
What? There is a huge crime wave going on right now in Panama?
Yeah, huge. I mean, like probably 3 days into Panama near a place called Bajo Chiquito, which is the first town you arrive in Panama after 6 days walking. You have indigenous people and Beta people, say the migrants, that are robbing everywhere. Everyone is being robbed because there's only one path to arrive into this town, and migrants have to arrive in this town. So there's only one way to arrive into town. And these little kids, you know, they're always like 18, 17 year old, are robbing everyone, are murdering people, are raping women. It's incredible sad what's going on today in the Darien.
Oh my God. Yeah, I mean, and when you say the people who are crossing from Colombia up to Panama, that they're going to be okay. I mean, that's considering that they're going to be okay from the criminals, not necessarily from, you know, the jaguars and the venomous insects and the diseases and the flash floods and all that shit. Starving. Well, speaking of starving, what do you eat? What do they eat? Because, you know, it's not a, from what I was looking at, it looks like a lot of the plants there, because there's an abundant amount of green, right? But it didn't look like a lot of it was necessarily edible. So what's the diet? What are you eating as you go through, and how do you put it together?
Well, you know, in the beginning, migrants used to bring like, you know, crackers and tuna cans. And since there's like this huge wave going on right now, people outside the jungle are selling so many things for these migrants to buy, you know. And the newest thing, you're going to laugh at this. The newest thing nowadays is to bring these, like, you know, like cooking stoves that are very small and use like a gas canister. I mean, they're incredible old. I think I had one when I was a Boy Scout when I was 10. But these are the new thing nowadays. So, and when I've been there, it's always the same, you know, like, or either way, you make a fire or you use that little stove. But basically, you cook rice, you cook like some canned food like tuna or, you know, hot dogs or whatever. You bring lots of coffee and you cook there. You know, I mean, if you're lucky, sometimes when you are with like some indigenous guy, maybe they can hunt something, some animal, or you can fish too. And these are great meals, basically. When you try them in the jungle, they're great after like 10 days of like eating rice and tuna can, you know, and canned tuna. So, but basically this is what everyone is doing nowadays. Like people is cooking there.
Huh. Really?
Because, you know, I mean, if you don't know the jungle, you're not going to know what to eat from the jungle. You know, you can see a fruit tree, but you don't know if this thing is poisonous or not, you know, so you don't want to just give it a try, you know, see what happens. So basically it's better, like, you organize your camping gear, your guides, you know, and when you stop walking in the jungle by 4 in the afternoon, you basically stay there, arm camp, and you cook, you know. And I mean, this is how I've been doing it for the last, I don't know, 14 years. And basically this is what migrants are doing. Like before they used to bring like meager meals, you know, like, and because of the weight and the heat and the tiredness, they keep throwing everything on the road. So in the end of the trip, most people don't have food nowadays. I mean, I remember 2 years ago, we were counting our food because our guys have to go back to Colombia. And what we usually do is going into Metetí and then Panama City. And then I take a flight back to Bogota or wherever I'm going. But the guys always need at least 2 to 3 days to go back to their town, and they go back walking. So we're like worried because we didn't have any food. We had like one more day of walking and we didn't have any food left. And the little thing we had is like food enough for the guys to go back to Colombia. And there's this little kid, I mean, this young kid, he's from Bangladesh. And he's right there. We're all camping together, you know, in this huge camp. There's like 60 people. And this kid is looking at our food and he starts crying. I mean, you can see the tears coming down his eyes. And it was just by seeing the food, you know. And it was incredible. I mean, you run into people like 2 days ahead from the start, and they already don't have food. And you know they have to be walking 4 or 5 more days. So
burning so many calories in that heat and going up those hills, right? I mean, we're talking about some of the hardest work these people have ever done in their lives. I, on the documentaries that I saw you in, these people were doing the absolute hardest exertion that they had ever done in their lives. I mean, you know, you're talking about, when we're talking about they're walking up hills, the hills are made of mud, right? I mean, I saw people just trying and trying and trying, and these people who are already near exhaustion had to go down and help a woman who just could not get up the muddy hill. And, you know, I mean, so, you know, you're just roaring through calories, right?
Oh, yeah. It's like, I mean, I swear, like, every time I go and do the big crossing, you know, like 6-7 days walking in the jungle, when I go back home, I'm pretty sure I lost like 10 pounds, you know, yeah. Like just by walking, because it's just a walk, you know. I mean, I don't do extra exercising in there, but you lose 10 pounds easy, you know.
So how bad are the insects and the reptiles and the...
You know, actually, like, what worries me the less is the animals, you know, because, you know, big cats like jaguars or other animals, they smell you. They smell humans from very far away, you know, and these are very cautious animals. They don't approach. Mm-hmm. So... It has to be very rare, like an encounter with a jaguar, you know. Then snakes are a different thing. Snakes, you know, snakes hunt at night, you know. So what we do every time we are in the jungle, like around 3:30 or 4 in the afternoon, we stop walking, we settle camp, we make lots of noise. If there's like high grass, we work out a little bit with a machete. You make noise. And if there's any snakes there, they're going to run, you know. Mm-hmm. They're not going to be around. Like when you encounter a snake that has already eaten and is chilling out in like a dirt path because it's sunny and they like the warmth, this could be dangerous. You know, like last year we ran into a huge mapana. And they say, doctors, they say, if you get bitten by a babana, you need to be at an hospital in 2 hours or you're going to die. But what you're going to do if you're like 3 days from the nearest town, right, which has an hospital anyway. So it's like,
yeah, right.
You know, we bring anti-venom just to keep the person that is being stabilized, you know, but I don't know if it's going to work. I mean, my guys, I've been traveling with the same guys for the last 5 years. These people I know very well. I know their families. they claim if you get bitten by a snake, they know certain plants that can cure you, you know? But luckily, I hadn't had the chance of trying those plants, so yeah. I don't want to know, you know?
Well, you know, when I would watch some of these, you know, see some of the migrants as they trek through, some of them I felt so bad because their faces had, like, just literally hundreds of mosquito bites. And, you know, yeah. Not everybody does well with a mosquito bite. Some people have very bad reactions. And they had hundreds on their face. And there is nothing they could do, right? So, I mean, how bad are the insects out there? It looked pretty bad from what I saw.
I mean, it's very bad, you know. I mean, once you know the Darien, I mean, let me tell you this. Like, the first time I crossed the Darien, I was incredible ill-equipped. I mean, I was sleeping on the ground, you know. I didn't have a sleeping bag. I didn't have a tent. I just had a huge plastic tarp that I would put up and I sleep over rocks, you know. And this is what happens with migrants, you know. They don't know where they're going, so they go very ill-equipped. Now, after 14 years of roaming the Darien, myself bought me an incredible good hammock with a mosquito net. So I don't suffer mosquito bites, but I know there's plenty. I seen these guys' legs. I seen these guys' backs because they sleep right on top of the jungle. You know, they sleep right there on the terrain with maybe a foam mattress or a tent, which is going to make no good because insects, when they feel warm, they get attracted, or when they see light, they get attracted. So if you're sleeping on a tent, you maybe can, like, attract huge spiders and snakes that are attracted to warmth. So it's a big mistake. The only thing to avoid this is sleeping on a hammock.
Oh, really? Okay.
You just hang yourself in the jungle with a good mosquito net. And then I swear I had the best happy nights in my life sleeping in the jungle, like, but in that hammock.
Like the Four Seasons.
You know, believe me, you need that hammock.
So, you know, we talked about the weather, we've talked about the FARC, we've talked about the cartels, we've talked about, you know, a lot of animals, a lot of living things here. What scares you the most? Have you had any situations where you're like, I might not make it? Like, I think this may be it. Anytime you can remember that happened to you?
Yeah, once I remember I got lost. It's like we're in the beginning of this stream up in the mountain, and we're traveling with some guys from India that we find there in the jungle. So we're just starting to walk, and this huge rainstorm comes in, you know, and it starts raining like crazy, and I see a couple of my guys walking already in the river, and I know behind there's like four other guys that I'm traveling with. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to take off too. And I'm just traveling, walking with this guy from India. He barely speaks English. So we're just walking. And at some point, the rain is so, so strong that I couldn't see like past a couple of meters. And my guys ahead, the two guys ahead, I lost them. And when I look back to see if the other guys are coming, they're not coming. And at this point, we're like in this little stream. I mean, it was like half an hour ago, it was a little stream. And now it's like kind of growing into a river, and the water is past my knees and going up. And I know in half an hour, I'm going to be like covered by water. This thing is like bringing water down the mountain like crazy. And I just see the river. I don't see paths on the sides of the jungle. So I don't know where to go, but I know I have to get out of there like at least in like 10, 15 minutes because the water is coming up like fast, super fast. So I didn't have a machete. I didn't have anything because I'm like with all these people, so I didn't think I needed one. So I just grab like a stick from some tree, and I start like hitting the grass and trying to go up into this rock. And finally, the Indian guy and I made it up to the rock where we know nothing is going to happen. I mean, it's super high. The water is not going to get there. So we're safe. But then we're lost. And it's like 5 in the afternoon. It's getting dark in the jungle, gets dark very early. And my people is gone. I don't know where they are. And at some point, I'm like, okay, I have a flashlight. I have like a plastic tarp if it starts rains again, and I don't have anything else. And I have this Indian guy that is incredible scared. I don't know how he's going to react when night comes in. And we might probably, I mean, if these people doesn't find us in half an hour, they're not going to go out and looking for us at night. It's impossible. So I'm like, probably we're going to have to spend the night here. And I'm like, this is the point when like you're like lost in the jungle. You don't know what is going to happen. And this is the point where you can feel like, okay, now like being alone with this guy and not so much noise, and we're in this like path that I don't know who's going through this path. I'm thinking one, jaguar, mm-hmm. and second, cocaine traffickers, you know, going through this path at night. And I think the traffickers are way, way more dangerous than the jaguar, you know. Jaguar, you can scream or try to run or throw a rock. Don't ever jump into the river because it's going to go after you right away. This I learned after this.
I'm going to take a note on that.
Yeah. But I'm thinking like, because we are on a path. I mean, the moment we went up to the rock, I see there's like kind of a hidden path. And I'm like, this is what worries me. It's like this path is being used by humans. And I don't know what type of humans. And if they are like people trafficking cocaine towards Panama, we're in Panama at this point already, we might run into huge trouble. So this was what was my main concern. And, you know, the other thing is like, you don't need to panic. If you panic in that place, you're going to start running. You're going to start screaming. You're going to attract people you don't want to attract. So chill out. And I'm trying to think all these things. And the Indian guy is desperate. It's like, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And I'm like, I don't know, man. If it start raining, we have this plastic tarp and we have a flashlight. So I think we're set. And the guy is going crazy. And then luckily, like, I don't know, 20 minutes later, one of my guys, I figure probably I went up when the river started, like the water started racing, and he took that little path and found me there.
Oh, good.
So we spent the night on a camp.
Before someone else found
but it
you.
Was scary.
So the most dangerous, here's my takeaway from that. The most dangerous thing in the jungle is a human, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
By far.
Yeah.
Not you.
Like always.
Like always. The greatest danger we face is from other humans, man.
Exactly.
Yeah, that is sad. So, you know, you actually have a website, villalonsantamaria.com.
Yeah.
You have some amazing pictures of this area on there. Those are some great pictures. So these came from all the different trips you've had.
Yeah, you know, I mean, this is like a 14-year work in progress, you know. And I told you it started because of migration, of what I read in that newspaper. But soon after I talked to this paramilitary commander back in 2005, I figured like the potential for the place, like the pictoric, the pictures potential of the place is incredible. I mean, you know, I have much more material that I want to upload into my webpage, but you can see, you know, like there's people logging, there's people looking out for gold. There's people hunting. There's like indigenous villages. There's like gorgeous scenery in this place, you know. I mean, it's a gorgeous, beautiful jungle. And there's so much more to do other than just migrants, you know. I mean, migrants are being, I've been concentrated on this story for the last 5 years, but I've been in Darien for 14. So for 8 years, I was photographing so many other things because I didn't see any migrants, and I knew there was all these incredible stories to be told, you know.
Well, from what I've, you know, from what I've studied, I guess the three primary reasons why they haven't finished the Pan-American Highway, right, or I think there's about four primary reasons, but one is just the damage to the ecology, right, just the damage to that very pristine ecology that's currently there. Second, the terrain is just horrendous, right? It's going to be very, very expensive to go through there. It's like mind-boggling expensive. Third is, you know, the intrusion upon those indigenous people, right? I mean, that's a really big deal. And I think both Colombia and Panama are concerned about the intrusion, though I think that argument might be getting a little weaker, right, with all the migrants passing through there, and because they're allowing a lot of that intrusion to occur by not, you know what I mean, by not handling that a little better. And fourth is, this is the weird one, and this seems to be the one that actually puts the hammer down, at least the last two times they've tried this, is the movement of equine diseases, or bovine diseases, from South America up to Central America and North America. They're like hoof and mouth and other types of diseases. There are certain types that are down in South America that aren't up in North America yet. And I think a lot of the agricultural folks have really put a stop on this because they're like, no, we don't want the transmittal of these bovine diseases up into Central and North America. So what do you think? Do you think that this will ever be built, or do you think that we need to double down in our protection of this area?
I mean, I wish it will never be built, you know. I think this is, as I said before, I think this is a very important place in terms of ecology. I mean, this is one of the only places on Earth where, like, species, plant or animal, from two different continents meet. I mean, you have species from North and Central America, and then you have species from South America, and at some point meet in the Darien Gap. That's why you have like an incredible amount of endemic species, you know, that only exist there. You know, Mr. Bolsonaro in Brazil is already destroying the Amazon rainforest like crazy. So we don't need to do this with the other only pristine forest we still have in the Americas, you know. So I really hope it never goes the way, because, you know, with the technology today, you can build a highway. There's no problem. I mean, the main problem actually today is like the Panamanian people. Panamanians are in a way very, very peaceful people. They don't even have an army, you know. They just have the Sena Front, which is like border police, but they don't have an army like Costa Rica. They don't like war. And they always been saying, if the Pan-American Highway goes from Colombia into Panama, the Colombians are going to bring war into Panama, you know. And it sounds crazy, but in a way it's true, you know. I mean, they had enough with the FARC and the paramilitary groups in the jungle.
Kind of their wall.
They say, if we build a highway for the Colombians, we're going to be on a full-scale war very soon, you know. Yeah. So this is one of the main reasons today, because Álvaro Uribe, kind of still the president of Colombia today. I mean, he started his presidency in 2002 up to 2018 or something like that, or 12. He was totally up to build the highway. But always since then, and since way before, Panamanians are always like, no, we don't want to bring in the Colombian war into Panama. You know, main reason nowadays.
Wow. That I did not know that, by the way. Thank you. That's actually pretty interesting. But what about that damn crime wave that's happening in Panama? I mean, like, how do you explain that with these peaceful people?
Yeah, you know, I mean, in Bajo Chiquito, if you see that hamlet, it's probably a hamlet that hosts, like, I don't know, all year long, like 400 or 500 people, you know, mm-hmm. indigenous and Beta people. But nowadays you have like 4,000 people in this little hamlet, still 400 and better people, and the rest are migrants. And, you know, these people, they're incredible poor. I mean, despite we are in Panama, the government doesn't reach these faraway places. So these people have no jobs. They're very poor, you know, and you have lots of... young people there, like kids, like they're like from 15, 17, 18, 20. And these kids are seeing an opportunity here. You know, I mean, they know the migrants have some money, they have mm-hmm. telephones, mm-hmm. they have clothing from other countries because they're even robbing their clothing. So they took the opportunity and they're robbing everyone. You know, I mean, this is something that I never seen before in Panama. I mean, in the cities, all cities in the world, there is some crime for sure.
But this is a village.
You know, but this thing in the Panamanian side of the Darien Gap is something incredible. I mean, you understand this in Colombia. You know, Colombia's always been at war. There's incredible amount of poverty, you know, there's armed groups. I mean, it's crazy. There's cocaine trafficking left and right.
And you live,
you understand this happening in Colombia.
For those who weren't here at the beginning, you know, Carlos lives in Bogota. So he ain't talking shit about another country. He lives there. So he knows.
Yeah. I mean, I've been living here for the last 20 years. So I know. I mean, you know, I hope Colombians are going to understand, but I'm not saying something that is a lie. You know,
yeah, everybody knows
this country's been at war for 200 years and it still is, you know, despite a peace treaty being signed 5 years ago. The country's still at war, you know.
God. So would you spend the night in that Panamanian village? Bathwa was the name of there?
Bajo Chiquito.
Yeah. Would you spend the night there?
Yeah, of course. You know, I mean, after 7 days walking in the jungle,
you arrive
to a place that has like 5 houses and a little store where you can drink a beer and a little restaurant where you can have like a warm soup. It's paradise, man. It's paradise. I mean, I love Bajo Chiquito, you know?
Yeah.
And people are not robbing in town, you know? They walk away into the jungle for like a couple of hours, maybe 5 hours into the jungle.
Oh, okay. Got it.
And pick a special path. Got to it. Wait for the migrants to rob them okay. there. I mean, Bajo Chiquito is super cool.
Oh, once you get to Bajo Chiquita, you're cool. You're good.
Bajo Chiquito is cool, yeah. man.
Have a good night. So, you know, before we go, what do you think the future holds for this area? What do you say?
I mean,
what do you think?
You know, I mean, if this huge, I mean, I know this huge migration wave is going to continue for a while because, you know, we're like kind of, or maybe not yet, passing through COVID, you know? So this huge migration wave belongs to like what happens with COVID in countries like Chile, Brazil, where there was thousands of migrants from Haiti, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's going to continue for a while, this huge. And I think when it regulates, you're going to have, like, of course, groups coming from Southeast Asia, some African countries, Middle East, you know, but not as huge as today. And I hope somehow these people get help, you know? I mean, it's super easy to help them. I talked to policemen in Panama, you know. You can take a boat in Necoclí, Colombia, and be in Panama City on that boat, let's say in 10 hours, you know, and Red Cross and, you know, UN for refugees could set huge camps outside Panama City and then do the same they do at the camps after you walk in 6-7 days, you know, in the jungle. They could do that super easy. One policeman told me once they didn't want to do it because that would encourage another migrants to take the easy path and be in Panama City in 7 hours instead of 7 days. You know, this is super cruel what he said, but, you know, they don't want more migrants, basically. This is what they're doing, this, like, let them suffer so they tell their friends at home, don't come this way, you know. It's very stupid politics, you know, it's not going to work.
I was going to ask you, because if you look at a map and you see where Colombia juts out and you just go straight across and you hit Panama, right? And I was going to ask you, why do people walk through the freaking jungle? Can't they just take a boat, right? You just go north.
So exactly.
And that's why, because they know they're coming, but they're going to suffer. We want them
exactly.
to
exactly. I mean, this guy, the guy's declaration was incredible because we were listening to this and he's like, well, you know, if we make it easy for them, everyone is going to come. So let's make them suffer so they get discouraged, you know, but I don't know. I mean, I don't know what's going to happen, but what I really would like to happen is like to preserve this place. I really think we need to preserve this place. You know, it's gorgeous. It's one of Latin America's lungs. You know, it's very important in terms of biodiversity.
Yeah.
You know, we need to preserve this place the way it is right now. I mean, before we destroy it, you know, because it really is going to serve us very well in case Mr. Bolsonaro keeps burning the Amazon.
Yeah, right. It might be all we got left, bro.
Exactly. There's nothing left. So I don't think to build a highway is necessary. We have planes today. We have ships.
You got planes. You got ships.
You know? Yeah. But places like this, we don't have many in the Americas, you know? Yeah. So my wish is to preserve this place. Now, talking realistically, what's going to happen to this place? I really don't know. I really don't know what could happen if you look at it from today, you know, from what's going on today. I don't know. It could be like devastation.
It could be. It could be.
Yeah.
And I just picked
absolutely.
That up from looking at some of the, you know, from some of the documentaries that I watch. And you can tell as you see the people walking through these paths, you see the garbage on the sides of the paths, right? And that has an effect on everything that you just mentioned. Well, one question I wanted to ask, and we could throw this back into the middle of it, like we'll re-edit this back into the middle. And that is, you know, on your journeys, Carlos, through the Darien, how present is death? Like, how present is death in your thoughts? How present is death around you? Like, how present is death on those journeys?
It's real. I mean, it's 100% real. It's not just on my mind, you know what I mean? On my mind, I try not to think about it because this is when you make mistakes in the jungle. If you worry, if you're scared, if you're thinking of death. But on the path, I've seen so many bodies, you know, I mean, in one trip 2 years ago, I saw 6 bodies right on the path, you know, and I was told of more that I missed or I didn't see. Today, people are talking of seeing like, I don't know, maybe 50 bodies on the same path, you know, like people are dying there. Like crazy because there's so many ill prepared to do this trip. So many of them are going to die. I remember once when we were with Jason Mothlack, we were just very close from the Panamanian border and we're walking through the jungle. And then the next thing we see is like a human skull on a stick, like pointing towards Panama, you know? So to me, it was kind of like, beware cartel, you know, that said, like, welcome to Colombia, behave here. I mean, this human skull, someone, I don't know if killed the person or found the skull on the ground, but just made the effort to put it on a stick looking towards Panama. So the people, the few people that is coming from Panama to Colombia, which in most cases are indigenous or hunters, are looking at this thing, you know, like coming into Colombia, and it's like, welcome, you know, crazy. So death is everywhere. You know, I mean, during the 90s, you had these huge wars between paramilitaries and FARC militias. So there's a lot of like murders in the jungle. And then you have like a huge corridor, cocaine corridor. So you're going to see violence. When you see cocaine, there's violence around, impossible to miss. And then with this huge migrants wave, you see in death like probably every day or every other day on the path you're walking towards Panama. You know, I mean, I know I'm sorry. I'm gonna go in 2 weeks. We're gonna go with this reporter from the Netherlands, and we're gonna do the entire walk, like 7 to 8 days from Colombia to Bajo Chiquito. And I'm pretty sure I'm going to see way more dead people than I saw 2 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. That's amazing. Cause it is, the shape of the people that I saw who are trying to attempt the trek. You look at them and physically, and God bless them. Right. I mean, they're trying to escape something. They're just coming with what they have, but you look at what you know, as I'm observing this, I know what's in front of them, and I'm like, oh God, that poor lady, you know, she survives. So, hey man, I can't tell you how much I appreciate you staying with me here and making this. And, you know, honestly, I'd love to talk to you again, maybe after one of your trips, because I am so, so, so interested in this, in the Darien Gap. And part of my journey is I want to get more people aware of where this place is and the special hold that this should have on all of us, because it is the last of its kind, really, in our, you know, in our Americas. And I want us to be aware of it and do what we can to protect it. And I think you're out there, you know, like a guardian over that area, making sure that we do so.
Yeah, thank you guys for the invitation. I think like you, I think it's super necessary to talk about this place, to talk about what's going on today, you know, and try to preserve the place. And then, you know, as I'm telling you, I think I'm doing like a couple of trips, more trips this year. But yeah, guys, I mean, I'd love to talk to you again about the Darien Gap and its, you know, wonders. Is in an incredible place. I mean, if you want to come over, let's do it.
Hey man, I might wait on that one, Carlos, if you don't mind. I might have to hold out on that.
All right, let me know. You know,
the Darien Gap is kind of like, I see mountain lions. Like, I love mountain lions. I love the thought of mountain lions. I love the idea that they're out there, but you know, I don't necessarily want to be around one. So I think I feel the same way about the Darien Gap.
Absolutely. I understand.
Yeah. But have a great trip on your next one with the film crew. And again, I want to make sure that people know that you have an amazing website, Villalon Santa Maria .com. And you have some amazing world-class photography on that website. And
thank you. Appreciate that.
Yeah. With your journeys. So thank you again, Carlos. I can't tell you how much I appreciate this. And I hope this is just the first of many conversations we have.
Great. Me too. Thank you very much.
All right, sir. Bye-bye.